This F-35 was just caught traveling over the speed limit as it was landing on the old Pacific Highway Road in California. And my god, is that a pedestrian? Oh no, it's just a landing site supervisor playing a game of chicken. According to the California state law, the pilot faces a $100 fine for exceeding the speed limit, since he touched down at somewhere between 50 to 80 knots during a rolling vertical landing. But here comes the kicker. The pilot could have landed while staying below the 15 miles per hour speed limit, as this fighter is in fact an F-35B, a version capable of vertical takeoff and landing. But why the speed limit is set so low on that road and what an F-35 is doing on it? Why the pilot is refueling his own aircraft, and what that has to do with the pilot shortage, and more importantly, why Facebook is a serious threat to American fighter jets landing on motorways, is not what you think. Landing aircraft on the road is nothing new. In fact, this has been a common practice for decades. The idea is simple. During a conflict, you want to disperse your forces as much as possible, so they're hard to find. As the Russo-Ukrainian war has shown, the initial staging air bases are highly vulnerable to missile and drone attacks. As a result, the Ukrainians began using their roads and highways as airstrips. Meanwhile, Russians were forced to move aircraft out of the Ukrainian missile range and cover many of them with tires to counter drone attacks. You may have even heard that the Eisenhower Interstate Highway System required that 1 mile in every 5 miles be straight, so it can be used as an airstrip in the event of a war. Again, the idea is simple. While an adversary can deny the use of a particular airbase by constantly firing missiles at it, it would be very difficult for them to constantly attack every single straight mile of road in a country. Too bad that a claim about 1 mile in every 5 miles must be straight is just a myth. But what is not a myth is that the US military spent 5 years identifying every single piece of concrete in the Pacific in order to find new places to fight from and be constantly on the move. It can be either small airfields, roads, and even beaches. This is all done under the growing threat of a conflict with China, which would mean that the current forward deployed bases across the Pacific would be at risk. Of course, the Pentagon won't say specifically where the possible expeditionary advance bases would be, but they are somewhere here, in the first island chain. My guess would be somewhere on the small islands in Japan and the Philippines. But it's not just the Americans who are experimenting with the concept of dispersal. In September 2023, the Royal Norwegian Air Force landed two F-35As on a highway in Finland. Immediately after, while the aircraft engines were still running, the F-35s were refueled in what's known as hot pit refueling. This was done in order for the aircraft to spend as little time as possible on the ground, because during a real conflict, they would be highly vulnerable to attacks. The US Air Force calls this concept agile combat employment. The US Navy employs a similar concept of distributed maritime operations, and the Marine Corps calls it Expeditionary Advanced Base Operations, or EABO. Now, you might be thinking, okay, I got it. Just use roads as airstrips. How hard could it be? Well, it's much more challenging and potentially impractical than you might think. You see, the US Marines landed the F-35B on this old California highway not in order to show off their skill set, but to figure out how to actually do it. In fact, this was the first time ever that an F-35 landed on such a narrow road. And don't worry, the pilot won't get a speeding ticket, since this old highway is now a training facility called V-STOL 101. It turns out that the easy part is in fact landing the F-35 on the road, given that the airplane can literally fly itself on pilot relief mode. The hard part is the logistics. How do you know which roads you can land on and which ones you can't? How do you prepare the roadway surface in advance? How do you get fuel there in time? What do you bring with you to set up a base? Obviously, you can't bring everything. How do you make sure that MV-22 arrives there on time with missiles? How do you manage air traffic control? The list goes on and on. Now, imagine doing the same in a conflict zone, when at any moment your base could be discovered and then destroyed. And that is exactly the challenge. Not only must the base have low signature, but but it also needs to be incredibly mobile, so it could switch from one temporary location to another. The lifespan of such a base could be as long as a few days and as short as a few hours. And they do this again and again as part of a much larger picture which involves hubs, spokes, and nodes. Just to be clear, the expeditionary advanced bases, or the so-called nodes, are not only rearming and refueling points, but also nodes for command and control, intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance, targeting and counter-targeting capabilities. They can even be used to stage medium-range anti-air missiles and HIMARS launchers, which would allow them to conduct sea control and denial operations. Specifically, Marines would be able to launch anti-ship missiles such as the Naval Strike Missile from the Marine Expeditionary Ship Interdiction System, or Nemesis. This would allow Marines to deny access to adversary ships in coastal areas around the first island chain. And this is where the real threat of the EABO concept is, putting all various aspects of warfare into one mobile unit. And it has to be done with a minimal number of people. Instead of having Marines do one thing, let's say rearm, they need to learn multiple skills. Even the pilots are asked to learn how to refuel their own aircraft. Speaking of pilots, I'm not entirely sure how pilots taking on more duties relates to the ongoing shortage of military pilots, but here's the story. The US Congress frequently asks Pentagon chiefs how the United States can successfully compete with the People's Republic of China or the current acute threat, Russia. But there is a much more urgent competition that directly and adversely impacts the US military, and that is the unhealthy competition between the US military branches and the airline industry. In a nutshell, the Pentagon cannot compete with the airlines, because the military is at a competitive disadvantage when it comes to recruiting pilots. For example, in 2018, the Marine Corps was able to recruit only 88 of the 203 required F-35 pilots. And by the end of 2022, the Marine Corps only had 218 of the 498 pilots required. According to the Marine Corps, while larger monetary incentives are slowly making some progress, they are neither sustainable nor an appropriate solution. With that said, the pilot shortage concerns are only part of the much larger recruiting challenges that the US military faces as a whole. While recruitment could be challenging at any time, during wartime, any nation faces a much more immediate challenge: logistics. Logistics is an even bigger challenge, constantly having to resupply military forces with fuel, water, food, medicine, and ammunition. While soldiers win battles, it's the logistics that wins wars. Between 2019 and 2022, the Marine Corps conducted 25 war games, which persistently highlighted how the current logistics concepts are not suitable for modern warfare. Again, you have to look no further than the current Russo-Ukrainian war, since it highlights how traditional ground resupply routes, even over relatively short distances, can be easily disrupted. And in turn, this leads to operational level challenges. So how do you resupply the expeditionary advanced bases? Simple, you just need to think outside the box. One novel idea, or maybe not that novel, is to use drones, like the Tactical Resupply Unmanned Aircraft System, or TRUAS. TRUAS can carry 150 pounds of cargo, such as food, medical supplies, and ammunition, to a maximum distance of 9 miles. An even larger command cargo UAV will be able to transport 1,000 pounds of beams, bullets, and band-aids up to 500 nautical miles away. While TRUAS will greatly simplify overland logistics, there are two new promising platforms that might be game-changers for seaborne logistics. First is the Liberty Lifter, a ground-effect aircraft that was announced by DARPA in 2022. This vehicle will be capable of strategic heavy lifts while flying at a very low altitude over sea, which help it avoid most threats. Since it can land and take off from water, the Liberty Lifter will be able to transport very large and heavy loads over long distances. Additionally, it will have the ability to fly, both over turbulent water surfaces as well as flying in mid-altitudes. It's worth noting that ground-effect aircraft are not a new idea. The Soviets famously experimented with chronoplanes in the 1980s. However, they proved incapable of flying over turbulent water surfaces, something that DARPA promises to fix with Liberty Lifter. The second platform is the Autonomous Low Profile Vessel, or ALPV, which are actually modeled after narco subs. Thanks, drug smugglers! Since ALPVs are incredibly hard to detect, especially at night, they are viewed as the perfect solution for tactical logistical operations to resupply distributed forces in contested areas. All three of the logistical platforms mentioned above are viewed as significantly less vulnerable to enemy threats when compared to traditional logistical assets. But it turns out none of them are immune, thanks to Facebook. To be clear, we're talking about expeditionary advanced bases on some islands in the Philippines or Japan that will be able to land an F-35 or C-130. This requires roadways which are about 3,000 feet long, and that means there will be a local population nearby, with cell phones and Facebook. You won't find a 3,000-foot-long road in the middle of the jungle, and even if you tried to build one, by the time you're done, the adversary would already know about it. The whole point of EABO is to use existing infrastructure. Now, it's not just Facebook, it's social media in general. The issue is that people take pictures, especially of things that are out of place, like an F-35B or MV-22, and then post them online. This makes it possible to not only geolocate, but also to put things together. For example, when the Russian separatists shot down the Malaysia Airlines flight MH17 with a Russian-operated Buk missile complex. On social media, multiple pictures emerged showing a Russian Buk missile system which was spotted in eastern Ukraine with four missiles, and then spotted back in Russia while missing one of the four missiles. Researchers investigating this tragedy quickly uncovered that the missile system belonged to 53rd Anti-Aircraft Missile Brigade of the Russian Federation, and even figured out who was operating it at the time. All this was based on public information and proved to be an incredible example of open-source intelligence. But this sort of information could be devastating to expeditionary advanced base operations. You see, the idea of expeditionary bases relies on the premise of putting amphibious forces in the range of enemy missile systems. This means that if the base is discovered, it would be quickly wiped out. To mitigate this problem, signature management is employed, which involves using passive protection activities such as camouflage, decoys, cover, and being constantly on the move. While Marines can take precautions against satellite surveillance, ban the use of cell phones, and monitor their own electromagnetic signature in order to avoid being detected, what they cannot do is to control the local population. And the Marine Corps acknowledges this in their tentative manual for expeditionary advanced base operations, stating that considerations must be given to the ability of the local population to observe Marine forces and post geotag photos, videos, or comments on social media that could pose a threat to EABO. In fact, when Marines landed that F-35B next to the I-5 highway, they were actually monitoring the social media to see if they had been noticed. The hard lesson is this. A few years ago, the Marine Corps came to the conclusion that they're not trained to fight a modern war. What is happening in Ukraine today only reinforces that belief. For this reason, Force Design 2030 was initiated, a force restructuring plan by the US Marine Corps to reshape its combat power, so when the time comes, Marines don't have to fight new wars with old strategies. This requires training, planning, and experimentation during peacetime. So when the time comes, they don't have to learn it the hard way.